Hey guys, this is Tim from Tim's Electronics Lab and welcome back to a new video. Now, before we get started, I'd first like you to ask to check the quality of the footage. If you mind, please compare it with the previous video because I'm playing around with my camera settings to get the best quality out of the camera that I can. So if you've got some time, please let me know in the comments down below if this is a better footage or a worse footage. So now let's get started to the actual video. Well, finally, this video is going to be about my oscilloscope. I've had it for, I think around 2 years now. It's the Siglent STS-1200-04X-E. Now, that means that it's a 4-channel oscilloscope, hence the 4 over here. And the 1200 means that it's a 200 megahertz bandwidth scope. There are 2-channel and 100 megahertz versions available of both the 2 and the 4-channel, so 4-channel 100 megahertz and 2-channel 100 megahertz and 2-channel 200 megahertz, and obviously that will be 1100-02X-E or 1200-02X-E. And you won't have these buttons. So, if I recommend you to buy an oscilloscope, or if you're looking into the STS series, I highly recommend that you get the 4-channel scope. It costs a little bit extra, but the things you'll get with the 4-channel option, it really is worth your money, every single buck. So, let's get into it, shall we? Now, if you start the scope up, this is your interface. I'll go over the basic UI, the buttons, to see what every button does. You can enable disable channels by pressing the channel button once the LED is on. So if I want to enable channel 1, press channel 1. And if I want to disable channel 4, I first need to press it so that channel 4 is selected. Then press it again and it will disable. And whilst you're in your channel menu, you've got a few options. You've got 2 pages. We start with the coupling, DC, AC or ground. Well, that's obvious. You can set a bandwidth limit, so 220 megahertz or full. You can do a fine and coarse adjustment. Now, this can also be achieved by pressing the vertical adjustment knob. See, now it's at coarse, and if I press it fine, it goes really fine, so you can really fine tune the scale if you want. The probe, obviously there are lots of options. The stock probes only come with x1 and x10, so you won't need the other settings. They're useful if you've got something like a high voltage probe or differential probe. So on to the next page. You can configure the signal actually on the next page. So the signal that goes into the channel. You've got units, volts or amps. Really useful if you want to measure the voltage across current shunt resistor. Then it will show everything in amps. The DSQ. You can invert the signal and do an offset. Now that's basically the same as twisting this knob. But now you are able to do it with this one. Visibility, trace, visible, hidden. Yeah, that's basically it for the per channel menu. And obviously that's the same for all the channels. And you've got the digital button. That's for the logic analyzer. It's an option that connects to your SBUS over here. And if you press it, a 16 channel, I'm not sure what the bandwidth is, but a 16 channel logic analyzer screen will appear on your screen. All right, so that's the basics of the channel, how you can adjust them. One thing to note, that's basically the standard on all oscilloscopes. This is a 4-channel oscilloscope, and in dual channel mode, meaning channel 1 and channel 3, we've got 1 gig samples per second. So that means that the ADCs that are in this oscilloscope are capable of capturing 1 giga samples every second. Now, it's written on the device in quad channel mode. You've got 500 meg samples per second. Why is that a thing? Well, this is one ADC and this is one ADC. So if you enable both channel 1 and channel 2, you only got 500 meg samples a second. And same for channel 3 and channel 4. So if you need to measure two rather high frequency signals, I recommend that you use channel 1 and channel 3, because then you've got the full 1 gig sample per second. It's written over here, sample 500 meg samples a second. So if I enable or disable channel 2, channel 4, you see it switches to 1 gig samples per second. Now if I disable channel 3 and enable channel 4, or channel 2, sorry, then you'll see it switches back to 500 meg samples per second. That's because these two channels and these two channels use one ADC. Little thing to mention. Now obviously on the two channel version, you've got only two channels, so this is 1 gig samples, and if you use them both, they'll switch to 500 meg samples a second. So little side note. Alright, so let's look at the probes. These are the probes. They are 2 megahertz probes, which matches the 2 megahertz bandwidth. I'm not sure if you'll get 2 megahertz probes on the 1 megahertz version. I think you do, because I see no reason why you wouldn't. And they're really nice probes. They've got these this attachment hook that you can use to attach your probe to a pin. The only thing that I noticed is that when too much force is being put on the hooks, they tend to bend a little, and then the sleeve that you pull back wouldn't go over it anymore. So you need to keep an eye out on that. You can also remove it, and then it's a probe. You can pin your signal really good with this probe. It's nice and sharp, but not too sharp. And you can remove this. This is a grounding part. And we come to the next thing of this probe. There's a ground attachment, and you can also detach that by pulling it out. Now you won't have a grounding clip, so let's put it back on and attach this. Over here you've got the times 1 and times 10 switch. This is times 1, this is times 10, pretty standard. And over here you've got a little hole that's used to compensate the probe. So as you can see over here, there are two hooks, a cowl and a grounding hook. Now if we connect it to the scope and now the Velcro tape that you hear is not included with the scope, unfortunately. If we connect it to the scope, you will see, always make sure that's using the full available bandwidth, so always max it out on your screen. That gives greater detail, makes full usage of the available ADC capture range. And as you can see, there is a 1 kilohertz square wave, that's if you get in real close, that you can use to compensate the probe. Every probe comes with a plastic bag like this, and there are a few things in there. Protection things, I'm not sure what this is. Yeah, you can put that on the back, I guess. Oh, no, this is, you can put this on your scope itself. Got a little hook, a ground probe hook, that you can shove over those grounding segment that you saw on the scope. Various rings, colored rings, and this is the thing that we need, a probe compensation tool. It's a nice flat thing that you can insert into the little hole, and you can fiddle it around. You've compensated your probe. So as I said, 200 megahertz probes, times 1 and a times 10 mode. You don't have an auto scope probe detect. Some oscilloscopes will have a ring which detects if a probe has been connected to the scope. Would be nice if they if that was there, but it's kind of a budget scope. So yeah. Well, I suppose we go on to the futures right now, and for that let me actually attach my signal generator. So I've got it attached to channel 1 and channel 3, sorry, so disable channel 2 and channel 4. Now, nothing is there. Oh, nothing is there. That's obvious because I haven't started any signal. Let's do a square wave, channel 1 and channel 2. Now, if I adjust the phase of channel 2 by 180 degrees, you can see that's right in the middle. Now, one signal is 180 degrees out of phase. You know that because I told it to you. And with the measure function, you need to select a channel 2 or channel 3, and then go to type, and you can, where it is, you can select a whole load of things over here, and one of them should be phase. There you go. Source, you need to select channel source, and then channel 1 as a source and channel 3 as a source for B. Then select phase, and we'll calculate the phase between channel 1 and channel 3. It's really nice. The amount of options that you've got available on the scope is enormous. Well, let's go back to channel 1. Nice workout with both hands, this review video. Well, peak to peak, maximum, minimum, amplitude, top, bass, mean. These are all rather obvious functions. They work well. If you select them, they will come up underneath over here. And you can also enable these statistics for channel 3. Well, let's do ST def standard deviation, and it will come up over there in the same color. Now, if you enable more things, well, let's do the period, frequency, then some of the others will fall off the screen. See, peak to peak is not there. Well, that's the only one basically. So you need to take that in mind. You can't show everything, you can only show a few. You can clear, that will wipe everything. Statistics, this will, well, this should show, or this will capture the statistics even when the channel is not selected. And if you do all measure, it will give everything. You can also do a gate. That means that you only allow the thing to measure for signals with the set gate. So I only want the thing to measure between here and then it will measure between these two. And now if I set the gate from right in front of the rise slope and set the gate right after the fall slope, it will measure between A and B, giving me a peak to peak of 80 millivolts, which is, well, next to nothing. So, really useful. That's the measure functionality. And let's go to the cursor. You've got a manual mode, track mode, and with tracking, it will, you can choose which cursor you want to change. X1, if you want to change X2, just press it and make sure it's highlighted in blue. And then you can twist this knob to track it. Now it's curious, because there you go. You can see that a little square has appeared on the screen, and that will follow the signal, hence the name track. So I want it to be, let's zoom in a little. I want it to be right at the edge of where it will fall down. Oh, that's a little bit. Obviously the resolution of the cursor is set with the horizontal time scale you have. Now I want to change the position of cursor 1 to be right at the angle. There you go. And now with x minus x2 minus x1, you can see the difference over here between those two markers. Obviously, I'm just measuring the high time. Now you can also measure that with the measure button, but this is just for demonstration purposes. And you can also do a manual mode, which allows you to select the channel. I think that's possible. Yeah, it's possible in channel, in auto mode or in track mode as well. You can choose channel 1 for your X source, channel 2 for your X source. You can use X reference delay or position. And with manual mode, I think you've got only one option for the channel, but you got X and I and XI tracking options. Really cool. Yeah, this is just the same. I want to do XY tracking. So you have four cursors right now. Well, two for the I and two for the X axis. This is also really useful because you can really pinpoint out signals from high and from low. Like that, you can measure the difference between those. Really cool. So definitely useful. Now, we go on to the acquire screen. You've got a couple of acquisition options. Normal, peak detect, average. Now it will take averages. You can choose how many averages it should take. Now this will impact the sample rate. As you're able to see, currently it's doing 70 kilopoints per second. Maybe, oh, I think it's because the average acquisition mode is on. Yeah, look, we've got 14 meg samples or 14 meg memory depth available. And as you can see right here, it's now using the full 14 meg points a second. So if we stop that, we can zoom in really far. And if we do that again, you see the signal. Well, it didn't change a whole lot. But it's not able to perform a out of window capture. So you'll only see, and it will only acquire the data that's in your screen. So if you want to capture a few cycles, you need to zoom out. Please stop, okay, sorry. So peak detect, it will, yeah, obviously detect peaks. And the RS, enhanced by bits, I'm not sure what this is. But yeah, haven't used it. And obviously you can enable XY mode. And it allows you to draw a graph. And it will halve your memory depth. So let's just disable that because we don't need XY mode. Let's go full memory depth again. See, it's reacting a little slower as well sometimes. So, well, interpolation, X or sinus X divided by X. Acquire mode, slow, fast. I think that this won't affect your memory depth. So, and sequence, I skipped over that, because now it allows you to acquire a couple of segments. And I think that if you use the history button, it will allow you to browse through all the five segments. You can set the interval, the scrolling interval. So I think if we set it to, well, let's do 1 second. You need to select which way you want to go with these buttons. So this will go, yeah, there you go. Will it repeat? No, it won't. Oh, that's a shame. And now it goes, yeah. So you can collect multiple captures and view the history based on, well, I'm not sure, some potentiometer that you tweak. Might be useful. I haven't really used it, so yeah. So let's turn off the sequence, and now the history is just going to use all of the available bandwidth that's got remaining to store the history in, without the acquisition mode or the sequencing mode being on. So display slash persist. Display, you can choose how you want to display your waveforms, dots or vectors. Now you'll get a whole lot of dots. Personally find this, well, not very visible. I'd like to have a nice line drawn between all the dots. Color grade, this gives a nice color to the signals. I'm not really sure what the color is actually based on, but I think it's based on where the signal is most of the time. So most of the time it's either high or low and not rising or falling. So I guess that's the color grade. Persist, well, you can choose to have some kind of vague history overview of your channel. And let's do a 30 second or 10 second. Persistence. And then if we zoom in and out, we can really make the screen blue and yellow, but that's obviously not what it's used for. If we clear the persistence and now we change the face, you can see where the signal has come from and where it is right now. And if we change the face back to 180 degrees, it will also happen in the reverse direction. So you've got the option for a grid, a small or a larger grid, or no grid at all. You've got the option to change the intensity. Not sure. Oh, the intensity of the waveform. Ah. Critical. I guess, yeah, that's the intensity of the grid. Now 16 is, or 15 is good. Transparency. Oh, this is the transparency of the UI messages. Transparency, cool. So this is basically display and UI things, which the name of the knob suggests. So save and recall. Well, you can do this to save setups, reference images, a binary containing all the gathered information, a CSV, a MATLAB. You can export to those file types. I'm not sure what the default key is. Oh, I think that's the. That's the default key. Really cool. You can actually adjust what the default oscilloscope setting will be. That's really cool. Now you can export, save to internal, save to external, press to save, USB flash drive not detected. You can actually export your settings, your setups, your probe, horizontal, vertical, position, divisions, all that stuff. And you, with the recall button, you can load those setups. You can load a reference. You can do a factory default or security erase. I guess that's the security erase is there if you want to sell the scope and you've got various proprietary waves stored in the device. I'm not sure. So yeah, I did actually use this feature a couple of times. Well, aside from the BPM, JPEG and PNG things, because you can also do that by pressing the print button. It will take a screenshot and start on the flash drive. I did actually export a signal to CSV. That's quite useful. And I suppose that the MATLAB export function is also quite useful as well. So, the other button, clear sweeps, that will just call or clear sweeps. I'm not sure if it does actually anything. This might be related to the AWG. The next option is the decode button. This is, well, I think the feature that I've used the most on the scope. And this is what's really good to have a four-channel oscilloscope, because if we take a look at the SPI configuration, you've got four SPI signals. Clock Miso Mozi and Chip Select. And with the two-channel version, you can only decode the Miso and the Mozi, unless you've got that 16-channel logic analyzer, which is rather expensive. So with the 4-channel, you can actually trigger on the Chip Select. And what's cool is if you use the setup button of the trigger, you can change this to do a serial type decoding, and you can change the protocol. So I2C, SPI, UART, CAN, or LIN. If you do SPI signal, we can, well, this is again, we can configure this, or we can configure the trigger setting. Miso, Mozi, bit order, but I think that there was also an option to copy the setting. If you press the decode button, it's an option to copy the settings from the trigger or to the trigger. And now if we copy the setting to the trigger and we look at the trigger, there you go, 2.18 volts. So this is really useful. You can set up the decode and then copy everything to the trigger block. And then you can configure the scope to trigger on these things. It's really cool. Actually, you can only trigger on Miso Mozi over here, but it will allow you to actually view Chip Select as well. Or you can only choose one signal. So you can only choose to decode Mozi, not Miso. So really useful. And when we go back to the decode, we can also turn on the list. Now, currently, I don't have a SPI device that I'm aware of that I can use to show this to you, which is a bit unfortunate. Otherwise, it will show the decoded information on the screen over here. And if you press the scroll, you can scroll using this knob and you can scroll through all the data. You can select how many lines the list should contain. And you can, oh, why does it stop? Okay. And you can save that to a flash drive, which is really cool. Tips, info, okay. It doesn't have a help menu as well. So, copy setting. That's really cool. If you hold a option down, you'll get a help menu. So, you can change the format of the decoded items. Hex, ASCII, binary, or decimal. I'd like to have it in hex, because that's what the datasheet is written in, or the protocol description is written in most times in the datasheet. So there are a few protocols, and you can also perform a second decode, so you can decode two things in parallel, which is quite useful. Well, now obviously for SPI you should only use two channels, not four, and list. Display decode 1, decode 2. Either you can display decode 1 or you can display decode 2. Long data, I guess that's the integer long. So this is really useful. And obviously you can also do UART, TXRX, channel 1, channel 2, channel 1, channel 3, sorry. And in the configure option you can set the baud rate. So the most common baud rates are in here, and if yours isn't listed, you can set a custom baud rate. You can also type it in. If you press the adjust knob, most of the times you'll be presented with a calculator style display where you can scroll to the digit you want to have and then press OK. So let's do max, shall we? Well, that's quite an impressive baud rate. And data length, you count over here, so you can adjust the data length, 5 bits, 8 bits, parity check, stop bits, idle level, low bit order, LSB. The most basic things that make up a protocol you can adjust. Now, I haven't used CAN. I don't really have a CAN enabled device. It's used for the automobile industry. And LIN, I think that's some kind of deviation from CAN. Or UART, I'm not sure. Maybe this is a single line, because I only see one signal source. Maybe this is a one wire serial protocol or something, because there is a baud rate over here. Really cool. This is definitely one of the options that makes this scope worth its money. It's really cool to have the decode option. So navigate. Yeah, this is just not the same as this one, but it allows you to move the waveform around. This allows you to scroll through the events. I'm first going to introduce the search functionality to you, because this is also really useful. And you've got various modes. Let's first start with Edge. You can change the source, channel 1. You can change the slope, rising, falling, either. So as you can see, there's a marker being placed on every, is that rising? So on every rise event, there's a marker. Now, what the navigate option allows you to do right now is we've enabled the search functionality. So if you go into the types menu, you can now select search event and press event num, and that will allow you to scroll through all of those events to have it centered in the screen, obviously. So that's really cool. And you can also do it like this. This won't start or stop scrolling. This will just stay at item that you clicked on. And I think that this should even work. Yeah, this works even when you're out of the menu. So that's really useful. Let's go to the next mode, slope. This allows you to mark a slope. So for example, let's do a falling slope for now. Falling slope, limit range. You can set the time that it takes for the slope to fall. Wow, this is really weird. So it works, but you can't set the upper level too high. Okay, a little bit weird, but you get the idea. You can now scroll through all the falling slope events. Pulse, that's used to trigger based on a pulse, so with a specific length. So what's the pulse? Around 50 microseconds. So you can enable this and it will give you every pulse that's between the range you specified. So if there's a longer pulse, you can see that it only lists the pulses that have a certain high level width, and others are not shown. So that's really useful. And there are a lot more search options. You can search for interval, round. Really cool, really cool. Another option of this scope is to do a rolling view, and it will only allow a 15 microseconds per diffusion rolling view. So if the frequency is too high, you'll just see this. You can also press this horizontal button and it will zoom. You have the full wave over here and you can zoom into the signal using the regular horizontal controls, and the top part of the screen will actually show you where you're at in the wave. So, well, really cool. Now, there is a ref button, and this will allow you to actually capture a reference waveform. So let's turn off the sweep. Let's just put the duty cycle on 50%. Yes, let's trigger. So source 1, reference location 1. Let's display it. First we need to save display. Now change the duty cycle to 80%, trigger again. And as you can see, it will show an overlay. Oh, that's a bummer. It doesn't go with the flow of your horizontal window. Oh, that's it's limited to the horizontal time base that you captured it in. As you can see, this blue line is the 50% duty cycle and the yellow line is the 80% duty cycle. That's really cool. You can also adjust the position. You can also adjust the millivolts per divisions, and of course you can turn it off back on. And you've got 4 reference positions. There's one button next to the reference button, that's the math button. And so you've got various operators. Well, the one that I last used was FFT, but let's go to See, sometimes that knob is a little bit itchy, the plus operator. So you can also do this at a, well, rolling, it's not really rolling, but in the continuous auto mode, I strongly suggest that you adjust the scale. And what it will do now is it will add the things up. Each waveform input is, channel 2 is 5 volts amplitude, and channel 1 is 5 volts in amplitude, and it will add them together. So I've got a 1 volt per division scale for both channels, and for the math operator I've got a 2 volt per division scale. So the total sum of the waveforms will get added up. It's 10 volts. So, and it shows the math setting over here. I'd like to have it somewhere around here or something. I think that's a little bit of a better place than random on the screen. So you can also adjust the position, or basically the offset, and invert it. And if we switch to the minus operator, we're ending up with an empty signal, which is of course obvious. I mean, 5 volts peak to peak minus 5 volts peak to peak is 0 volts peak to peak. And we can do it, do channel 1 times channel 3, 2 volts squared per division. So we end up with a, I think we should end up with a 25 volt signal. Yeah, 25 volts squared. So yeah, that's a little bit above 25 volt actually, because it's not perfectly at the division line. Yeah, that's the inaccuracy of my AWG. I still need to calibrate it. If you set a amplitude of 5 volts, it's going to be around 5.2, not 5. We can divide it. 5 divided by 5 is 1, which is, well, spot on. And now comes the fun part, FFT. Well, it's a 10 kilohertz signal, so let's do FFT, maximum 1 meg point, window handling. You can set a few windowing methods. You can use auto set, it will adjust the FFT settings to what it thinks it's the best mode. Yeah, that's the update mode. Normal, max hold, or average. Now, max hold is equal to peak hold. It will hold the peak or the maximum value at that specific point. Now, using the horizontal and vertical menu, you can actually adjust the window. Let's decrease the amount of hertz per division. Now, the duty cycle of the rectangle is 10 kilohertz. So there are a few resonance frequencies, as you can see. You can also adjust the vertical, the scale, reference level, unit, and external load. Tools show peaks, table or by amplitude or frequency, and markers or no things at all. Search config, threshold, excursion. I think that's the some kind of the, yeah, it's basically the same as a search function that allows you to perform an evaluation on the signal. So if you only want signals above 5 dB volts or below 20, minus 20 dB volts, you can do that. And if I enable the sweep functionality, but now on the frequency, it will create a frequency sweep of 10 to 20 kHz. So as you can see right now, turn off and turn it back on, the new FFT plot between 10 and 20 MHz, it's all flat. And if we change the vertical scale, you can really see that it's going down at 20 MHz and that it's starting at 10 MHz. Yeah, you can do various fun stuff with the FFT. There is a boat plot function in this scope, but you can also do a manual boat plotting function with this feature. So that's really cool. Let's go to the next operator, D divided by DT. So yeah, you can set the DX value and scale. So that's really cool. Source channel 1, channel 3. Yeah, that's basic math. Or you can do the square root of DT. Yeah, this is the function stepping that you're seeing right now. You can perform a gate on the signal. Source offset, yeah, this speaks for itself. Or you can just do a square root of the signal itself. So that's it for the math. I forgot one button, that's the utility button. That's because it's the least interesting. You can view the system status over here. View the software version, hardware version, U-boot, and all that stuff, and serial number, but I'm going to obviously blur that. Press single key to exit, so do self-calibration. This is needed once in a while. I've had it a couple of times that I was measuring a signal and I thought that my scope was accurate and that the signal that I was expecting was supposed to be 3 volts. And I measured it with my multimeter and it was 3 volts, but with my oscilloscope it was around 1 or 2 volts. And then I was like, hey, this is not good. So I ordered a new voltage regulator. And then I discovered that the output voltage was the same. And I tried to probe another signal with my oscilloscope, a 5 volt signal, and that showed up as 3 volts. So then I did a self-calibration and it was all fixed. But I was like, wow, this can happen real quick. The calibration gets, well, out of date. Nice tool that self-calibration is included. So you can change the language. These are all the language options. A utility pass fail IO. This enables you to change various things of the IO, of the oscilloscope, USB device, well, you can't really change this, but this is for the USB interface at the back. Network interface LAN, well, it's set to LAN by default if you don't have a USB Wi-Fi adapter. IP set, well, this allows you to set your IP address or view it. Now, under the utility button at page 2, there's boat plot 2. And I'm not sure why it's under utility, but here's your boat plot. In a previous video of mine, I showed you how to connect the FY6900 AWG, non-Siglent AWG, to a Siglent oscilloscope, as Siglent only allows Siglent AWGs to use for a boat plot. That's a little bit unfortunate. It did not remember the IP address. Oh well, I need to figure it out. Yeah, you can adjust all these things and perform boat plot, amplitude phase, auto set, cursors, all that stuff. Data, you can save the boat plot data, list, scroll, save, recall. Oh, you can load, oh, that's really cool. You can load boat plot plots as well. So yeah, boat plot, well, really useful, but only if you've got the AWG. Otherwise, it's not really useful at all. And the final, or the not final page, you've got the update, firmware, configure, USB flash drive. Yeah, you need a USB flash drive with the latest firmware on it. Self-test, screensaver. Now, I think, yeah, you can adjust the screensaver. So I guess that this also works with the trigger. If it hasn't been triggered in a while, I think it will enable the screensaver. But if it's continuously triggering, I might be wrong. Maybe it's only UI related. You've got various options, and these are software options. So type AWG install, enter the serial number to install your AWG, and information. Yeah, you've got temporary licenses, and in here you can view how many times you can still use them. Utility reference position, fixed position, horizontal delay. Not really sure. I think it's for the deficient system, the reference system. Power online. Oh, this might be the option that enables and disables the LAN interface of your scope when it's powered down, because by default the LAN interface of your scope is powered down. When the scope is, well, off, it's just in standby. So that might change that setting. AWG, well, it's not detected, so I can't do much. And you've got a web server which allows you to control your oscilloscope through a web interface, which is really cool. So yeah, that's the utility page. Yeah, the print option allows you to take a screen capture of the screen and store it on a flash drive. And menu on off allows you to enable or disable the menu. Run stop allows you to run or stop the signal or the capture. Auto setup, well, this sets up the scope with the most ideal parameters to capture the signal, but it's not really ideal because I don't want to have a 2 volts per division bandwidth. I'd like to have a 1 volt per division bandwidth, or ideally a 700 millivolts per division bandwidth, because I don't need those weird peaks at top. So, and I'm not sure how auto setup is detecting the voltage. Maybe it's using a safe zone, but it's, yeah. And default, this allows you to go back to the default initial state of your oscilloscope. Well, not initial state, it's not a factory reset. Oh yeah, the frequency sweep is still running. It's not a factory reset, but it allows you to, with the save and recall, you can save the setup to default key. If you press the default key and you have saved it to the default key, then it will open up that setup. So I think I've covered everything of this scope, yeah, except for the digital and the AWG stuff, because I don't have a logic analyzer or Siglent AWG attached to the scope. At the back, there are a few ports. On the right side of your scope, you've got the power connector, obviously protected with a fuse, really nice. And over here, you've got a LAN interface, a USB interface. This is USB host, this is USB device, and pass fill or trigger out. And I think that's used to synchronize various other devices to this device. So yeah, that's basically it for the backside. And as I said, the LAN interface will be disabled when you've got that option set up. It's a pretty small scope, as you can see. It's not really that big. This is my hand. It's Oh, it's got a nice form factor, actually. Cygland provides special software, I think it's called LabVIEW, that you can use to connect to your oscilloscope via the USB interface on the back. And it allows you to gather data from it and set up the thing and all that stuff. All in all, I think for the 900 euros that I paid for it, this is one of my best purchases for the lab. It's a really, really nice device. Really nice oscilloscope, especially for, well, starters that got a little bit of a budget limit and aren't able to afford like 2000 euro oscilloscopes. It's been quite a video. I mean, I've been recording for about 2 hours right now. So I will thank you for watching. Please let me know if you actually going to buy the scope, or if you actually going to buy the newer version of the scope if it's available. I can highly recommend this scope, as the support for the scope from Cygland is, well, excellent. Thank you guys for watching, and see you in the next video. Bye. Hey guys, this is Tim. I hope you liked that video. If you want to see more, please make sure to subscribe. You can also share the video with your friends and hit that like button. I'll see you in the next one.